What's happening, ladies and gentlemen? This is Min from Architecture Inspirations. Today, I'm going to show you 10 tips for a realistic exterior rendering using V-Ray 3.6 for SketchUp. Let's get started. First of all, if you have not seen my video on 10 tips for a realistic interior, you should definitely watch it because some of those tips may apply here as well. Now let's jump on to number one. Number one, model in detail. For example, let's compare these two models. They have the same design, but one has way more details than the other. So when I render them, even without materials, you can see that one is clearly more realistic than the other because of the huge difference in the level of detail. Adding more details usually comes down to two things. One is to find good 3D components. For example, the original windows in my model don't look that bad, but if I find a better one on 3D Warehouse and then replace them, you can see that it already looks so much better. The second part of adding more details to your model is to model the details yourself. For example, in this model, I want these types of siding for my building. Instead of finding a material that would represent it, I can actually model the sidings themselves like so. This way, it'll look more realistic, especially in corner areas like this. This modeling process can get a little complicated, but if you guys want to learn my workflow, let me know in the comment section below, and I will create more videos on modeling techniques. Another example is instead of using a roof material on a flat face like this, I decided to model the roof shingles themselves like so. Sometimes a small detail makes a huge difference. And this is why adding details to your model will always make your render look more realistic. Number two, study references. When you're looking for ideas for designs or adding details to your model, it's important to use references. I often use resources such as House and Pinterest to find photos that I can use as references. References can be used as inspirations, but they can also help you create an accurate and realistic model. Also, whenever I don't know the dimension of a specific element, I can look it up using Google and then make sure what I'm modeling is at the correct scale. This tip does not only work for 3D model of your building, but it also works for texturing and other types of modeling such as site modeling. Number three, model a good site. Similar to the first tip, it's important that you also put in a lot of time when modeling the sites of your model. A lot of people just place their building on a flat site where everything is on the same level. This is far from realistic. In real life, things are built on different levels. The sites around your building is more than just a flat surface. So if your building is next to a road, take the time to add the curb and sidewalk, etc. As mentioned in the last tip, this is a good time to look for references online so that you can model your site correctly. If your building is on a different site where the ground undulates a lot more, then use tools such as Artisan and Sandbox to model the terrain. The Artisan plugin costs money, but the Sandbox tools is completely free and it comes with SketchUp by default. So I will focus on this tool in this video. First, if you don't see it on your toolbar, then you can go to View, Toolbars, and turn on Sandbox. The tool that I use the most from the Sandbox toolbar is the Smooth tool, which is used for sculpting the terrain. But for it to work, you need a surface of triangulated irregular network. There are many ways to create it. You can create it from scratch using this tool, or you can create it by manually subdividing an existing surface like so. Now I can sculpt the terrain by using the Smooth tool. I can set the radius by typing in a measurement and then press Enter. And when I move the terrain, I can also type in a specific distance as well. After you're finished, you can soften the terrain for a smoother surface. You can always go back and edit the site whenever you want. To make it easier to see the edges, just turn on Hidden Geometry, and then turn it off after you're done editing. Number four, realistic materials workflow. Realistic materials are super important for getting a realistic render. Here is my workflow for realistic materials. First is to download PBR materials. If you do not know where to download PBR materials, then watch this video about the top websites for getting materials for free. Number two is to create realistic materials using these PBR maps. If you don't know what PBR materials are and how to use them, then watch this video to learn how to create realistic material using PBR maps. Third is learn to apply materials correctly. This means applying materials to scale, in the correct position and orientation. For flat surfaces, you can right-click a face and use SketchUp's tools to make adjustments to the textures. Number 5. Creating realistic grass. There are several ways of creating grass in V-Ray for SketchUp. One is using V-Ray Fur. To do that, first you need to select a grass surface and make sure it's in a group. With that group selected, click this button here to apply V-Ray Fur. Then go to the Asset Editor, and in the Geometry tab, I can select the V-Ray Fur geometry and expand the settings using this arrow here. Now I'm going to run the interactive render and adjust the settings a bit to make it more realistic. Here is a closer look at my settings. You can copy this setting or create your own if you like. When creating multiple grass areas, instead of creating a new V-Ray Fur component each time, you can go into the existing group and copy the V-Ray Fur component, then go inside the other group and paste it there. You can place the component wherever and it will automatically adjust the size and turn the new surface into V-Ray Fur. This also applies the same settings, so when you edit it, all of the instances will change at once. I also want to point out that since we adjusted the terrain of this grass area previously, the grass has a form that's more natural than just a perfectly flat surface, making it look more realistic. The second way of creating grass is by using Scatter. Scatter is a powerful extension for scattering objects inside of SketchUp. You can follow this link to get a demo or to buy it. To create grass, you can download grass components from 3D Warehouse, then use this plugin to scatter the components on a surface. Remember that this will create a lot of geometry and it might slow down your model, so it's a good practice to convert the components into proxies before scattering them. To make the surface look better, make sure to have a base material for the grass area. The cool thing about Scatter is that you can always go back and adjust your objects parametrically. You can also use this plugin for other objects, such as trees, rocks, debris, etc. Scatter also has its own library, which helps create grass very quickly and easily. It also provides several other types of landscaping elements, such as flowers, bushes, rocks, and even trees. This takes me to number 6, 3D trees and plants resources. As mentioned in the previous tip, Scatter has trees in its library that you can use. Another plugin that has really high quality trees and plants is called Lopwork? Lafak? Laufek? I don't even know if I'm saying that right. Hold on.
Laufek.
Yeah, that.
Laufek
is a plugin for creating realistic trees and plants for your 3D model. I'm using the free version, which has 5 different plants. It might not look like much, but each of these have 3 different variants, 3 ages, 4 seasons, for a total of 180 models in one kit. For this model, I use these options to create different trees to populate my model. This helps avoid having the same component again and again. The cool thing about Lofek is that all of these plants are proxies by default. This makes it easy to add trees to your model without slowing down your SketchUp. The last place to find 3D trees and plants is the 3D Warehouse. Although, you need to take your time and be selective when finding the component that you want. And again, when using these high-quality models, remember to use proxies before making copies of them to avoid slowing down your SketchUp. A problem with using free models on 3D Warehouse is that it's hard to find variants of the same components, so it might look unrealistic because all of your components look the same when you render. This takes me to number 7, which is avoid repetitions. When placing multiple instances of the same component, try to avoid repetitions. For example, you can see that while this looks very organized, it's really unrealistic because you can tell that all of these models look the same. But if I rotate and scale each component a little, then it will break the repetition. It's a small change, but it can help your render look more realistic. Number 8. Combining HDRI and sunlight. If you've used HDRI, then you're sure to have encountered some lighting issues when using it. A problem could be the lighting or shadows of the objects is not sharp or visible enough. This is why I sometimes combine both HDRI and sunlight when render, so that I can use the lighting of the default sunlight while using the HDRI mainly for the background image and the reflection. However, there are a couple of things that you need to keep in mind. First is the settings of the HDRI. I only want to use the HDRI for the background and reflection, So I would turn on effect diffuse, effect specular and shadows. And sometimes I like to turn off effect alpha as well. This is so that I can have a transparent background in case I want to make any changes in post-production. Number 9, render settings. People often assume that render settings will automatically make your render look more realistic. But in reality, there is no such thing as a perfect render settings. To be honest, if you follow all of the previous tips, then your rendering should look realistic even with the default settings. With that said, there are a few changes that I make to get ready for the production renders. First, I make sure to turn off interactive and progressive. Then change the quality to high. I also like to turn on the denoiser. You can also edit its settings in the render elements rollout here. I will also add some more render elements, such as material ID, refraction, reflection, etc. Here, I usually add an extra text channel, then input a dirt map. This will be used later to add ambient occlusion to the render. If you want a simpler way, then you can turn on ambient occlusion in the global illumination rollout. Next is camera settings. This actually depends on your scene. Usually, I would use this to brighten up an interior scene, but for this exterior render, the default setting is good enough. If you want to learn more about camera settings, then watch this video here. And finally is the render output, which will depend on the scene and personal preferences. I usually set mine to 1920 by 1080 or 3840 by 2160 if I need a larger render. Number 10, post-production workflow. Post-production is important, but it's not super important if you've done most of the work in the 3D model. However, using it correctly can help your render look even better. I've done lots of Photoshop tutorials in the past, so I will walk through this process really quickly. First, I'm going to add a bloom effect, and then add contrast using a high pass filter. Then I'm going to bring in the extra text channel and overlay a brown color to make the building look a little dusty. Next, I'm bringing in the diffuse channel to add some more details on the sidewalk and road. Then I'm using Nick Collection to add some cross-processing and sunlight effects. And finally, I'll finish it off with some lens flare. If you want to learn all of these workflow in detail, then check out my Photoshop playlist. And those are the tips for a realistic exterior rendering using SketchUp and V-Ray. If you're looking for a similar tutorial for 3ds Max, I would suggest you take a look at this course on Skillshare.com, who is also the sponsor of today's video. Skillshare is a learning community with over 22,000 classes in design, photography, and more. The premium membership will get you unlimited access for less than $10 per month. But as part of this sponsorship, Skillshare has set up a 2-month trial for the first 500 people, so you can watch all of their courses completely for free. If that's something you're interested in, then go to this link here. I will also leave the link to the course I just mentioned earlier, which is Exterior Rendering with 3ds Max and V-Ray. This course will show you step-by-step tutorials from modeling your building, adding realistic materials, modeling terrain, to lighting, and editing in post-production with Photoshop. This course is made by the same author who created the course on interior renders with 3ds Max and V-Ray. That's another good course to check out too. That's all for today, guys. If you want to get this model to learn more about my process or simply want to support my channel, then follow this link here to download it. It's also available for my members on Patreon at a lower price. Just make sure to sign up before August 30th. Thank you so much for the ongoing support. Leave a like if you enjoyed the video. Comment below what I should do next. Stay inspired, guys, and I'll see you next time.